Hallelujah. There's a mess. There's no one that don't hear me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's stand as we reverence this man of God as he comes. Look, every Sunday, I'm praying that more people start utilizing their gift. Thank you, Minister Heller, for that great exhortation and transparency on what God will do. Because I'm not going to be here all the time. But God said there's some people in this ministry. I'm waiting. Minister Starling, she preaches every Sunday. She don't know it. Hey, now we got Minister Brown over here. We got to get him ready for his first sermon. We got Sister LaShonda, who's probably going to be the best exhorter when she gets to her places. Y'all don't hear me. It's people right here in this ministry that's ready to do the work. I'm waiting for Sister Deanna to give her testimony. Look at your name and say, name is right here in this ministry. Everything we need is right here.
Whatever you need, God's got it.
Yes, he does.
Whatever you need, God's
got it.
He got it.
Yes, he does.
I don't know what you came to do.
All right,
but we serve a God that's worthy to be praised.
Yes, yes.
And I'm thankful that the atmosphere has already been set in this place.
All right.
Having said all that, we're going to go to God in prayer, and then we're going to go into the Word of God. Amen.
Amen.
Eternal God, our Father, we just thank you for this day. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for bringing us to your house of prayer one more time. Thank you for what our eyes have seen. Thank you for what our ears have heard. Most of all, we thank you for what our hearts have already felt thus far. We thank you for the exhortation that has went forth thus far. Now we dive back into your Word. Father, I ask that you allow me to decrease so that you get all the increase. Let the words of my mouth, let the meditation of my heart, let it be acceptable in your sight. For Father, you are truly our strength, our sustainer, and most of all, you are our redeemer. It's in the Son Jesus' name that we ask you now. Amen. If you have your Bibles, will you travel with me? Before we begin, let me show you how God has already worked. 2 days ago, I was working on a message. This morning, God woke me up and said, "Scrap that, I got something for you." And as I have been in the back, just being fed by praise and worship and by the exhortation that has went forth, everything that has happened lines up with what we're about to talk about. See, that's how God works. Because you don't know, he's already seen the future. But it's up to us to be obedient to walk through it. See, sometimes we start walking, and then when stuff gets hard, we stop and then we turn back. And so the progress that we made, we will throw that all away because we are focused on our circumstances. And we allow our circumstances to affect our worship. But if you have your Bibles, if you travel with me to Job chapter 13, there's the A clause of one scripture in there that has actually already been mentioned today. And that would be verse 15. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
If you don't have it, say hold on. Job chapter 13. Verse 15a. And I'm reading the hearing from the King James Version. And it simply says, "Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. For a thought I would like to use, I would like to challenge you, I would like to encourage you, I would like to motivate you, because that's what I do. Circumstantial living leads to circumstantial worship. Circumstantial living leads to circumstantial worship. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Job, my man Job, my man, having suffered incredible loss and enduring terrible circumstances, declares that he will continue to trust God even in the midst of that struggle. But let me give you some background on my man Job. In the first chapter of this book, we find that Job loses everything. His oxen and donkeys are stolen away from him. His sheep are dead. All his camels are stolen. But verse 20 gives the key for this lesson. Then it says, then Job arose and rent his mantle and shaved his head and fell upon the ground and worshiped. As I think of this verse and the actions of Job, I wonder how many would respond in such a manner. To get the news that you just lost everything. Not some, not part, but everything. You get this news, and yet you decide to set your heart to worship.
All right.
Now, isn't the first reaction a reaction of anger when you find out that you lost everything? So y'all not going to be honest today. Don't you shake your fist at heaven and declare an answer for this apparent abandonment of God?
Yeah.
Don't you ask the question of why? Why me?
Yeah.
Why my children? Why my livestock? Why all of this at once?
Yeah. That's right.
If I can be transparent as well.
Okay.
I'm guilty of this.
Amen.
Because that is the very thing that I did all of 2016. But when you know better, you do better. So I turned over a new leaf in this year 2017. Can you sense the grief, the confusion, the uncertainty that Job must be going through? Even in the midst of all these powerful emotions, Job finds better comfort. He finds his comfort in knowing, in worship, rather than in questions. Some of y'all didn't catch that.
Yeah.
He finds a greater desire to worship than to understand his circumstances. I think this is because Job understood the difference in circumstantial living and in true praise. True praise is not offered to God just because things are going as planned. And I couldn't be happier with the results. True praise is lifting our hearts to God in praise when things aren't going as planned. And I couldn't be more confused or more hurt. This is the lesson of Job 13 and 15. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. I wonder how many of us would express the same thoughts given the same circumstances. Or for us, do we live circumstantially to offer circumstantial praise? Here's the point. Job had no circumstantial reason for which he should praise God or even trust God. Remember, he lost everything. Everything that he held dear was gone. There is no evidence that God is working on Job's behalf. It is as God is on an extended vacation. How many of us have felt like that sometimes? When we're going through our struggle, we ask ourselves, God, where are you? I'm here. You know, I'm your son. I'm your daughter. I know you ain't forgot about me. I need you. It appears that God is totally disconnected from Job at this point in his life. Could God really be nearby and allow all of his these animals to be stolen and killed? Could God really be involved in Job's life and allow all of his children to die? I mean, if God were there, wouldn't he have done something to stop all of this? I believe that many would not do as Job did. They wouldn't seek to praise God given the circumstances, but would rather begin to bombard heaven with a verbal assault of questions and accusations. Of course, this is what the devil was counting on Job to do. But he decreed and declared, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Satan was speaking to God in verse 11 of the first chapter, and he said, but put forth thine hand now and touch all that he has, and he will curse thee to thy face. You see, Satan had all the confidence in the world that Job was a circumstantial worshiper. Satan's argument to God was that you pampered this guy. You allowed everything he does to prosper. You've increased his livestock. You've increased his house. You put a hedge around him. And you placed him in his little protective bubble. How many of you all know people that act like they got it all together, but when the storms happen, they fold up like a cheap tent?
Get what we expect.
Some of y'all will catch that when y'all get home. The point is that God uses unique situations and circumstances to teach us valuable life lessons. That's why I don't respect people that ain't went through nothing. You don't know how to stand when it's time for you to stand because you ain't been through nothing. Not to destroy our faith in Him. How we react to any given situation is purely our choice. We choose the attitude we take on every day. That attitude will either develop in us a pure desire to worship because He is God, or not worship God because of what we're going through. I read a story about a Holocaust survivor who wrote about his experiences in a Nazi concentration camp. He says that everything can be taken from a man but one thing, the last of human freedoms, to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances. Many of us, many days of our lives, we categorize as bad days simply because of negative events that happen in the day. For example, for all my working people, someone asks you how your day going, and it's 8 o'clock and your response is, it ain't going good. I woke up late and I ain't had my cup of morning coffee. Now already, you have chosen an attitude for the day based on the fact that you didn't get that cup of coffee. Already we've chosen that attitude, and the reason is, it's so easy to do that.
That's right.
Label a day as bad because someone on the freeway cut me off.
Or
the clerk at the convenience store where I get gas was rude to me. Or my significant other asked me to take out the trash on my way out this morning. Just because you weren't in the mood to hear that, you have already declared subconsciously that this is going to be a bad day.
That's the truth.
But here's what we need to know. Here's the caveat. We must be careful because anything can set us up for a negative attitude for the rest of the day. When that happens, any negative circumstance, will cause us to possibly miss out on our blessing during that day. What's important to remember in times like these, that God is working behind the scenes. Job wasn't aware of the fact that the enemy had made a bet with God that he would crumble the moment that God took his hand off him. Now, worship in any negative situation takes faith. It takes faith. Faith to believe that God is seeing this situation from all sides. The limited view I have isn't the same view that God has. My limited perspective isn't the same perspective that God sees from. In the same way we worship God, it's like we're saying to God, I was reading this book and it said, it's called Worshiping Your Way to a Higher Perspective.
All right.
And it talked about a little boy being with his father in a massive crowd, only seeing the backs or the legs of these grown men. But the child wanted his daddy to pick him up, put him on his shoulders so he could see through the crowd. Now, the thing about it is, in the same way we worship God, we're saying, Daddy, pick me up so I can see better what is going on in my life.
Yeah.
I don't understand all of this.
Yeah.
Help me see it better. Worship is the elevator that lifts our perspective.
Yeah.
I'm going to say that again.
Yeah.
Worship is the elevator that lifts our perspective. God is on the outside looking in. We're on the inside looking out. He sees what we're going through without the haze of confusion. It really comes down to a matter of trust. When life is bringing certain events my way that I don't understand and I can't wrap my brain around it, the question is, am I going to worship God or focus on the problem? Will I trust that He has a better view of it all rather than my own limited thinking? And that's what we have to be careful of. Because what happens is, it will affect our friendships.
Right.
It will affect our walk with Christ. It will affect our relationships. It can affect our marriages. It can affect our families.
That's right.
We got to be careful about that.
Yeah.
So the way that you normally start the day, it sets the tone for everything. Sister Stormy talked about how when she gets up every morning, she starts off with the praise. She starts off with the dance. Mm-hmm. How are you starting off your day?
Yeah.
Every morning.
Yeah. Amen.
Because your day starts before you get that cup of coffee.
Yeah.
It starts before you hit that job.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It starts when God opens your eyes.
Yeah.
And he gives you the strength to get out of bed.
Yeah.
What is the first thing that you do? Some of us will hit the snooze on the alarm clock and go back to sleep.
Yes,
and we're going to be honest about it.
Yeah. Yes, be God.
But that's a little better than complaining. Well, we have to remember that God is all powerful. He is omniscient and he is omnipresent. He never stumped. He's never stumped or stupefied. He's on top of all things at all times, even when we are not on top of our game.
Yes.
There was not a moment in the afflictions of Job that God didn't have a close eye on him and Satan.
Yeah.
He was mindful and watching his servant, cheering him on, giving him silent strength to get through the terrible ordeal of losing everything, including his own health. You see, when I wake up in the morning, there are affirmations that I say. That's affirmations I say. Every morning, without question. Before I leave that door to go to that job that I tolerate. Because that's not my gift. See, what I'm doing now is my gift. I didn't go to a class for this. This is something that God placed in me. But see, here's all the affirmations that I say every day. And when you do something every day, it becomes consistent.
Yeah.
You consistently do it.
Yeah.
And the fact is, it throws your day off when you don't do it.
Yeah.
It just doesn't feel the same. So what I say, and this is what I say to God, it basically says, I will listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit within me.
Yeah.
I will lead and not follow.
Yeah.
I will create and not destroy. I set new standards. I defy the odds. I am a leader. I am the head and not the tail. I am the lender and not the borrower. I am above and not beneath. I am loved by God. I am chosen by God. I am protected by God. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. And every tongue that rises up against me in judgment shall be condemned. I am a champion, and everything I touch turns into gold. Everything I am seeking now, that you did prior to hearing this message, shame on you. So as I close, we have to remember, God is in the mix, in the midst. He is in the midst, he is in the mix. He is not a far-off spectator. He's right here, behind and before us, to help us through the circumstances that we go through on a regular basis. We have to resist the urge to become circumstantial worshipers who only praise God when everything in our lives is going good. But in all things, give praise to God who is worthy now and forevermore. Rule your circumstances with praise rather than letting your praise be ruled by your circumstances.
Yeah, that's good.
And if you need need help being reminded of why praise and worship is so important. There's a song, we sing it all the time, but do we really know, do we really understand the words of it? And I'm going to leave you with it just by saying the words as I go to my seat.
Okay.
It says, praise is what I do.
Yeah.
When I want to be close to you,
yeah.
I lift my hands in praise.
Yeah. Yeah.
It says, praise is who I am.
That's what it
says. And I praise him while I can. I will bless him at all times. Understand the importance of the word vow. The song says that I vow to praise you through the good and the bad. I'll praise you whether happy or sad. I'll praise you in all that I go through. Why? Because praise is what I do. But it didn't stop there. It says praise is what I do. Even when I'm going through, I've learned to worship you. Know my circumstance doesn't even stand a chance. My praise outweighs the bad. Here it comes again. And I vow to praise you through the good and the bad. I'll praise you whether happy or sad. I'll praise you in all. Why? Because praise is what I do. God bless you.
Praise the Lord.